everyone, we'll be discussing part 10 of A Suitable Boy today, and part 10 and 11 actually. And yeah, as usual, Diksha's going to be joining us quite soon. She's actually out right now, she's just reaching home. And yeah, we'll begin in a couple of minutes. Then we're having people coming in. Invite Rajesh, Shreya Sachdeva. Nice to have you guys here. We'll just be beginning in a couple of minutes, guys. So, how many of you are actually reading A Suitable Boy? Like, if you could tell us in the comments if you are reading or have read A Suitable Boy or have watched the series, because right now we are about 50-60% through the book. I know the series is already out, so a lot of you might have actually watched the series, but do let us know how you're liking the book and if you've watched any of our previous videos discussing any of the parts, and what are your views on both the series and the videos. From now on, we'll be doing two parts per week. Earlier, we used to do a single part every week, but now we'll be sticking to two to kind of speed up the process, as there are 19 parts. And now that series is actually out. I don't know why I'm messing that up. But yeah, now that the series is out, have any of you watched the series yet? And if you have, please, no spoilers in the comments, but because we're actually just reading the book for the first time and we're just 60% through. So, yep.
Diksha will be with us shortly, so we can start this. I'm really sorry for the delay, but there was some issues there. But yes. Yeah, everyone who's joining in, please let us know if you've been reading A Suitable Boy or have read it or have watched the series, and what are your views and opinions as of now, or if you've seen any of our previous discussion videos, and if you have any comments or feedback for us, please let us know. Hi Toshi, I know you've sent a request to be in the video, but I think you'll have to offer your comments through the comment box. Hey Bound India, you've read the book and watched the series. Okay, without any spoilers, can you please let us know how did you like the adaptation? Because I've been hearing mixed reviews from people. And firstly, Diksha and I haven't watched the series yet. Diksha has watched a couple of episodes, but she hasn't watched the entire series. I'll watch it only once I'm done reading. So we're just kind of waiting to hear from people about how they like the adaptation. So it'd actually be great if Bound India, you could tell us through the comments if how you've liked the adaptation, if they've done justice to it. Because I think that's something about the book that stands out, right? And that was something I was skeptical about right from the start. About how reducing a magnum opus of almost 1400 pages to 6 episodes is, I don't know, a difficult job. But Meera Nair is the only person who I would trust to be able to do this. Hi, Shyam Shonky. Hello, Curly CJ. Oh, that's great that you finished the series 10 seconds ago. Can you tell us how you like the series? Where do you feel, or did you like the adaptation that was made of the series? Did you think it went better with the book? If you've read the book, Bound India felt like it was made for a foreign audience. It got better after the first episode. That's actually what I've been hearing as well. Like, I mean, that the English felt, I don't know. It's not that it was bad acting, but it just felt that that's something that a couple of my friends who watched it felt like it was adding a lot of. How do I frame this? It made it sound seem wooden to an extent, which the characters, while reading at the very least, do not. It also reduced a lot of the caste politics and completely eliminated it. Yeah, that's something I figured would might end up happening because unfortunately you always have as I mentioned, right, it's at the end of it was a 6-part series and it's a 1400 page book. A 1400 page book, and the beauty of the book, at least till now, at least till part 11, is that they're exploring caste politics quite explicitly, but still there's this strong undercurrent of how they're exploring it by demonstrating different equations and different actions, or how people from certain castes or classes behave, which I don't know how. I mean, it's definitely difficult to capture in a movie anyway, and especially when you reduce it to like 6 parts only. Like, I personally thought this might have been much better on a grander scale of, say, like, I don't know, at least a season of 24 episodes, or maybe, I don't know, longer, which could have done justice. Curly say, Jay, agree with Bound India and also felt very hurried, but that's understood considering how long the book is. Yeah, exactly. I don't know. I mean, I think that's a question we should always I kind of pose to Netflix about why did they choose to reduce it, or if maybe something you can speak to Meera if we ever get to speak to her about that. Why did she reduce it to a 6-part series? What was the point where she decided this is how I want to adapt it? Because it's obviously bound to feel hurried. Like, you really can't capture something like when Lata was in Calcutta and exploring the city and, you know, gets fallen in love with the city. That's something very difficult to capture into a 6-part series, right? Like, just reducing it to 6 episodes. Diksha's with us now. I think she's just about to, I'll just add her to the live. And yeah, she's on the live right now. We'll just.
Hi.
Hey, Diksha, what's up? We were just.
What's going on?
So we were waiting for you, and we were discussing if people who've read the book or are reading the book and have watched the series, etc. And we were just
Have
discussing.
you seen all 6 episodes?
I haven't. No, I haven't. Apparently, there are a couple of people on our feed. Bound India has both read the book and watched the series. There's another person by the name Curly Say Jay who just finished watching the series like about 5-10 minutes ago and is now on this live. So
Nice.
that's great. So apparently one of the comments that we got is that it felt hurried. It felt like it was made for a foreign
Yeah.
audience, and it kind of reduced the caste politics to a very minimal this
Oh
thing.
my God. So I'm
Right.
on episode 3 because that's where we're at right now. Like, if I move to episode 4, there's major spoilers ahead. So
Oh.
thankfully, my friend actually told me where I'm at and she told me which episode to stop at. But the accents threw me off completely. Like, I know when we did this live initially, we spoke about how anglicized the book is, and obviously I expected the show to also be like that. But man, the accents, this is 1951 India we're talking about, and people are like, it's not just Arun who has this British accent. Oh my God, it's so it's unnerving. And I mean, now that we're discussing it, dude, the casting, why is Lata so fair? The one thing we keep hearing throughout is about how Lata is dark, right? We hear about how she has this big eyes and great smile and like all of that. But the fact that they, like, literally my reaction was like, why is Lata so white? And like, I couldn't take her seriously after that. Like, they just completely ruined it. And this is just classic what, like, basically they do during movies and shows, right? Like, they make everyone white and like traditional.
I'm just surprised because Meera Nair is known to be quite considerate while making these shows, right? Or like her previous work has been very accommodative and dealing with all of these things. And
That's
I
true.
don't know
And
why she failed with
I
this.
mean, obviously there's an argument to be made that they maybe just really like the actor who played Lata. I don't know her name, and like, she's
Right.
great. I don't quite like her because she smiles too much, and Lata in the books is very like brooding, and like,
Ah,
she's not the most like
fair.
smiley,
Smiley person,
lively
right.
person. Yeah, so I didn't like her too much, but she's a great actress. So it's possible that
Right.
that's what it was, and they didn't care about skin tone. But I feel like when that's such a huge part of the narrative, right? When we're talking about Indian wedding scenario, making being someone who's marriageable and all of that. Skin is such a color of your skin, sadly, is such an important thing, and for them to ignore one of the things that really define Lata and the challenge that Mrs. Rupa Mehra seems to have about finding her daughter a suitable match, right? I feel like that was a really like missed opportunity. But I'm excited. Like till part three, the series has been fairly slow. But I heard that 4, 5, 6 was too like condensed and like how it
yeah,
should have been
that's
spread
that's
out much more.
that's actually one of the comments we got. And in fact, a very strange thing happened. My mother doesn't generally watch like shows or anything, but recently she decided to watch shows, and she started off with A Suitable Boy, and her reaction was, "Oh, is it over?" Because she, I don't know, so I think she was expecting more episodes. She's quite new to this entire thing, so she thought maybe like there's a weekly thing coming or something. And
So she surmised
that she thought the show was abrupt. That's the only takeaway I have. But I think that'll be an interesting discussion I'll have with her once I've read the book.
And people are coming to me and asking me, "Who are you rooting for?" And I'm just like, where we're at in the book, there aren't even like relationships so established that we're rooting for anyone. Like, there's Lata and Kabir, yeah, sure, but like, we don't really know what's happening with Manakshi's brother. We don't know Haresh is really a thing. So I don't know if there's like, are we like, is this it?
All over the place, right?
Yeah,
but,
is this it? Like, are we supposed to have like our couples decided right now? I don't know. I'm like,
I don't think so. I don't think we're, maybe a couple of more parts, but based on that, let's come back to.
Which is a great segue to like how we wasted two more parts here reading about things we don't care about.
Yes. I think that's a good summary of part 10 and 11. Actually, to be very fair, I found part 11 at least to be like, okay, full disclosure, I'm a lawyer, so I quite enjoyed part 11. And
I was reading it and I was like, oh my god, I have zoned out so much, but Siddharth's going to love this stuff.
Yeah, because we'll go chronologically, we'll get there. But just to summarize for everyone else, part 10 is essentially carries on with Maan's exploit in Debarya and his this thing. He goes.
I feel like exploits is an incorrect word for what he's doing. He's actually, for once, it's not his exploit.
Exploits. Yeah, okay. Like, follows his drone.
His travels.
Life, his travels, I guess. He goes hunting and he goes to his friends. Fort and
Better
he,
house.
Right. And he sees, I think, again, we see this continuance of. A narrative where he's actually being shown the real world, the kind of grassroots level discrimination that happens. We also see a much more nuanced side to Rashid about his life issues and how he faces them. His act finally gets caught and how his family deals with it and how the village is actually reacting to this entire ecosystem with Maan fitting in. That's largely what part 10 is about. And very honestly, again, I think this is something we had to complain about part 8 or 7, which was the previous one which dealt with it. It's decently written. It's actually well written, but there's not a lot to grip the reader going forward. I think I still struggle to kind of have that association with Maan as a character, which makes me like, you know, sympathetic about him finding, I don't know, something at the grassroots level.
Part 8, part 10 is Maan's like redeeming arc, right? Like that's what it's about. It's telling us that, yeah, okay, we send this guy to Kanpur to like, run his own business, and he didn't do that, and he was like basically a lakhandar, but like he has something, and he's connecting with people, and he's finally getting to know, and he's coming of age. So that's what these two parts are about. But the way it goes on and on about the village ecosystem, I don't know if it's going to add up later, but it's extremely confusing why we're getting to know. So we don't necessarily see what Maan's thinking through all of this is. We see what he does, but it's always from the point of view of someone else, which makes, I mean, if you're talking about the main character, let's hear what he's thinking, right? Which we get a lot with like Lata, and we're not necessarily getting that with Maan at all, which is why I think what you said, we can't connect with him because we see him as a third person. We don't really know what's going on in his head ever.
And okay, so a very weird thing happened. So I have this thing about updating my Goodreads as and when stuff happens. So once I was done with part 11 and I put in the page number, it turns out we're done with about 58% of the book. Right.
I can't believe that.
Yeah, but that's the thing, right? I mean, okay, so ideally at 58% in the book, my plot has somewhat cemented and I'm heading in a particular direction or two directions at best.
Yeah,
right now,
like if
right
it's a movie, this is a conflict zone, right? You already know what your character stands for, what they root for, and you're like in the middle of a conflict right now.
And right now, I don't know, the book just feels all over the place. Like, I have 5-6 different plot lines playing forward, and none of them are heading in a way
still
where they're reconciling.
Yeah,
and yeah, like, I mean, if just trans going to part 11 where we deal with the lawyers and the babas at the fair, and it's just
Raja of Mar.
Yeah, the Raja. I mean, it's, I mean, I can see the plot progressing, but it's not adding up to anything. I mean,
so clearly, like, the Zamindari bill is what part 10 and 11 both sort of talk about, right? Like, that's right. The sort of main character, if you must, of like these two parts. And like, I mean, we don't know how that's going to affect anyone yet. So unless Maan becomes like a politician and like he sits through the Zamindari bill and like that's the ticket sort of he contests on, we don't know why this is relevant to any of our characters. Okay, we have a comment, I think.
Yeah, the exact opposite felt in the series. There was already too much happening by the second episode. Yeah, I guess, I think that's so real. I mean, when you condense like a 1400 page book to 6 parts, that's also, as someone pointed out earlier, I think Curly Sage pointed it out earlier, that it felt hurried, and which is true. I mean, okay, so coming back to something that you mentioned, right? Even if like Maan decides to take up that political arc, my point is that till now we've been reading Vikram Seth and we kind of have an understanding on how he's going to go about it.
Yes.
If in 60% of the book he's gone from being that Lafunder to this person who's discovering this thing, I don't see like the book ending in some way to the extent that, I don't know, 40% of the book doesn't seem like a lot of time for Maan to kind of transition into
redeem himself
to find himself in a political atmosphere or something. Also, because I think we should do this together, I'll just summarize part 11 as well. Part 11 is essentially the court challenge to the Zamindari bill. And that it deals a lot with proceedings.
He was studying while he was actually reading a book.
No, it was quite cool because this is something you study in constitutional law, if anyone ever does it in law school, that this was one of the earliest conflicts of the constitution where the constitution kind of guaranteed your right to property, that no one will forcefully take your property away. But at the same time, the parliament and the executive wanted to break down the Zamindari, as we see in the book, wanted to do so. And this actually was a key part of our constitutional jurisprudence for like 20, 25 years.
Is what the proceedings and stuff. I'm sure you must have read.
Right.
Like,
so in terms of the case law cited, it's made up. But in terms of the arguments made, they're actually jurisprudential arguments from all sides. But
what is Article 14? I think Article 14 is mentioned.
Right to equality. Yeah. Right to equality.
Mentioned.
Yeah. So that's the point. So the entire challenge revolved around the fact that in India's history, since like independence, what has happened is the government has always tried to be pro-poor and like, you know, break down the Zamindari system and distribute land. While Zamindars had eventually always like ended up challenging. I am in law school and the way you're stressing it, I'm leaning towards reading the book.
Don't read the book for just one chapter. Rather read your case law book.
Yeah, but yeah, like the way it transitioned from, so essentially what happened was the Zamindars would use their right to property, which was a part of the constitution, a fundamental right, to constantly challenge it and say that, well, we're being deprived of a fundamental right we have. And that actually forced the government to amend the constitution, the parliament to amend the constitution, which led to further challenges. And like, it actually just, the biggest debate you ever had is how much can you amend the constitution was like literally a result of similar bills like this. So yeah, like it was quite interesting to read it because for anyone who's interested in constitutional law, these are literally what forms the core of any constitutional law debates in the country. And it's very interesting because they do capture a lot of the terminology or the court proceedings or behavior in a very accurate manner. Even though like the bar has evolved in a lot of other ways, the argumentation styles or the way you talk about judges or the way you know, the theatrics of actually pleading in court and pleading to a particular judge, knowing what to say, reading the court, stuff like how this Banerjee, the lawyer, is like, oh, I'll sense the mood of the court and then make the argument. Or this judge is irrelevant, or like how I'll go about it. Or it's the simple fact that calling that it a conference and not a meeting is it's a litigating thing that, oh, you have conferences on your cases, not meetings. It's something I never got the terminology behind, but that is an actual thing. So in that sense, yeah, I was quite accurate to a very broad extent. I'm sure the theatrics, like the Raja of Mar standing up in court and like shouting, is not something that happens in high courts at the very least. I'm not too sure about district courts, but yeah. But the other part, I Brahmapur just seem can't seem to catch a break. Like they had a
Dude, they
riot,
had
they
a
had a
riot,
stampede.
now they have full mail.
Stampede.
But my God, what a way to bury the lead, guys.
Yeah.
First of all, I mean, yeah, constitutional law, great, interesting, whatever nonsense.
Yeah.
This was about Kabir. Finally, Kabir is
Yes.
back and
Back.
Kabir
We're
saves
safe.
the child.
Yes.
Like
And
Veena,
his redeeming
Veena.
factor.
Yes, he's like, and there's the scene where Mahesh Kapoor goes like Durrani and like questions his surname, but like still goes and thanks him and stuff like
Right.
that.
I personally felt that was from, I think he was building that university professor association in his head.
Yeah,
I
which
didn't
I
feel
really liked.
communal.
Exactly. The
Yeah.
minute he said Durrani, I was like, oh my God, we're gonna
Is
hear
he
this
going to?
revision stuff again, or like, is he going to remember that Lata? Because Mr. Mahesh Kapoor keeps on hearing stuff from his wife but doesn't register anything. So I was wondering if the Lata Association will come up or not at any point. But I don't think anyone made the Lata Association. No one sort of understood that.
But I see it heading in that direction for sure. I mean, this is clearly like a
Do you
huge
think this
plus.
gives hope to Lata and Kabir?
Of course it does. I mean, suddenly he's not just like a member of
Boy.
another, yeah, like of not screwed, just a boy. He's not no longer a Muslim boy. Like it just adds a whole new dimension to his personality. However shallow it is for the for that entire
Yeah.
extended broad family. Like I think now Kabir might have people on his side to kind of convince, which is great. I
Yeah.
mean, we've been rooting for Lata and so in terms of, but in terms of romance, this, both these chapters were had nothing, absolutely
Nothing.
nothing,
And
right?
I
So
really thought I was picking up a romance novel when I started reading this book. That is my main problem, dude. I feel so deprived.
I mean, to be fair, you did pick up a boy called this book called A Suitable Boy, so that's a reasonable expectation to have. I mean, I won't take that away from you at all. But yeah, clearly, like it's just, I mean, see, that's the thing. I mean, I love whatever Vikram said it's doing. It just feels all over the place right now. Like I'm at the end of this 11th chapter part. I'm just okay. This book really needs to start getting its, shit together and
But
just kind of.
that's, I mean, what's the saying? If you walk into surgery midway, it looks like a murder, right? So, I mean, maybe, see, the thing is, I feel like our at least mine, I don't know, I don't want to speak on your behalf, but expectations in terms of this book are so off, right? Because I really came in with no context. Like, I haven't read about it, I haven't heard about it. I obviously heard about it, but I don't know the plot. And I thought I'm picking up a romance novel, but then I got to know I'm learning more about a city. Then I realized I'm learning more about like just different professions. Like you mentioned, the whole law bit is so well defined and explained. But even with Harish and Kedarnath's profession, the whole shoe thing was so well defined and the marketplace was so well described, right? So I think what we're really reading is just like about people in a certain time in our country. And the problem with that is that this is a group of extremely privileged, extremely the right religion, extremely anglicized people that we're reading about. So it's very difficult to make that connection. Like, we don't know what's really happening. Like, I still don't know if what we're expecting out of Maan over here is going to be finally a romance or not. Are we going to know whether Maan finally gets engaged, or are we just, is Maan's story just like a coming of age, wake up Sid kind of a story, and Lata's is a romance
No,
thing, right?
so I agree with you on all of this, right? I'm not denying any of it. It's, the only thing I'm trying to say is that even if it's that book, right? Like the book that it is, that it talks about the political social scenario of a very particular moment in
Yeah.
our history, right? And also focusing on a very particular group of elite rich people with, right? But
Right.
my point is that, well, it's a book at the end of it, right? So you do expect it to follow
A
at
story.
a broader pattern where to the extent that you do start off like let's take on the like the analogy bought what right like if you walk into the middle of a surgery it seems like murder where
Yeah.
essentially we started watching a surgery and we can't figure out what the surgeon's doing because he opens the heart and then he just goes to the stomach and then he goes to one of the arms and right now everything's open nothing seems to have shut and he says I'm going to shut it in the next 30 minutes which is freaking me out right now. Like I'm 60% through the book. I don't really know how he's going to wrap up everything in the next 40%.
just
And
give me more Chatterjees, man. That's
I
all I want.
know
Like,
Chatterjee for what, barely a chapter or two
I
chapters,
don't
I'd
know
say.
if chapter 12 introduces us back to Chatterjee. I don't know what chapter 12 is about. Like, normally I tend to glance to the next chapter to just know who our main character is going to be, so I have something to look forward to. But I don't know. But if it's not, like,
Can
I
I
don't
say
love
just one
that.
thing? Can I just say one thing? It's Mrs. Rupa Mehra for sure. Like, I ended up turning the page, so I just saw it starts
Oh.
with Mrs. Rupa Mehra. I know where
So
they
we're gonna
are or where
probably
we
get
take
like
this, but
Haresh and Lata, I'm assuming.
I'm
Oh
guessing.
man, I just want Chatterjee's, dude.
I don't know. I'm kind of hoping with Dipankar being brought into this one, there might have been some. There might end up being some. I don't know. Chatterjee's this thing.
What do you think of Dipankar's character? We didn't discuss that at all. We didn't acknowledge.
Okay, so honestly, I felt okay, so I don't know how accurate my assessment is. Felt like one of those exactly what it was, that a rich brat is going to a spiritual experience, thinks that in 9 days he's learned everything to know about the universe and the world, and he's just decided to go ahead on it, which is felt again, it, as much as it happens, it is what it is. It's a superficial experience. He's not really I mean, sleeping in on a haystack for 9 days doesn't really change who you are as a person. There's a lot more that
I
goes
don't know.
into it.
I've never done it. You've never done it, so we shouldn't make judgments.
Okay, let's put it this way. Going through a hard experience for 9 days doesn't really change your this thing. I mean, we've all done that. We've had those kind of experiences where we've like, I have once slept on a stone bench at a train station.
I'm really sad that I don't know that story. I will catch up with you on that later.
But this was not in India, this was in Switzerland. I missed a train, but
Oh
that's
my
not far.
God, that changes everything. You were freaking Europe. It's so not the same thing.
Yeah,
Anyway, coming
but
back.
anyway,
But
yeah,
like, I don't know
yeah.
why we're hearing about Dipankar. Like, what does it add up to?
Maybe the only thing I could take away from that is that maybe it's a segue for the Chatterjees into Brahmpur. I don't know, like maybe he decides to stay there and like someone that
See, I think the
Chatterjees know
Chatterjees are
more.
going to come to like Brahmapur now because like this one is going to have a baby soon, right? Lata's sister.
Right. I
So
mean,
I know the, I think that's when like they'll come back and stuff like that. But I don't know. Also, do you think we're gonna read get to know more about Meenakshi's brother? Like, do you think that's a potential true love interest?
I'm not too sure. Okay, so that's the thing. I think from one thing that we have gone through the book is that Lata has like some sides to her, and like, funnily enough, each character appeals to one particular bit, right?
Which I really am liking.
Yeah, so I mean, I definitely would want to see him again, and I think we will, because I think that's the essence of the book, right? When Lata is faced with certain choices about her own self, because she's at all these points, she's okay, maybe something more. For Kabir, her love is just like inexplicable, can't be explained, but she does feel for it. It maybe kind of reminds her of that rebellious, free attitude she has. Her love for like Meenakshi's brother just seems like one of those things that, you know, how she reads and how she has a more slight fascination about finer things in life, and not in the way her brother has, like, you know, in the way he wants to emulate the Britishers, but something like explore, like just the way you who loves to read, who loves somewhat some culture in their life, kind of adds that dimension to her. While Haresh is just like the one of those things
Nice
that
guy.
add, yeah, nice guy who right at the first instance you won't really like, but then you kind of just see yourself developing somewhat feelings for him, like someone you can settle for, right? That's
So
the
are we convinced that Like, sorry for interrupting you, but are we convinced that these are the three main characters now? Or do
I
you think we're
mean,
gonna get someone more?
I really hope not, because I don't, I mean, then I would genuinely not like the book, because it would definitely be very rushed then. I mean, you really can't introduce someone like 3/4 into the book who's going to end up
A
being
true
like,
contender for
yeah,
your
I mean,
view.
there's no like, I mean, right now we've had Kabir's build up for like 12 parts now. Like, Kabir was there from the start. Okay, Haresh was also introduced in the first few parts. Meenakshi's brother came on later on, but still like very early into the book for us to talk about his character development or his family. Like, I don't know. Either it has to be someone from the existing families, if there's just like a brand new family or a brand new character who comes in who's like a possible suitable boy, that will just I don't know, kind of annoy me. It just
And
will
again,
throw me off.
taking your bets on the whole Maan thing. Do you think Maan is going, like, I see Maan going the whole political angle now. Like, I feel like he's going to be because there's talk about Mahesh Kapoor wanting to leave Congress and all of that. Again, I don't know how factual that is because we're talking about Nehru leaving the Congress, but anyway, let's not get into that. But I think like basically Man's gonna help his dad establish his like presence in like a new constituency, that Ruria, I think that's how you pronounce it and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So I see that being Man's angle and not what I initially thought it should be, him like also finding and falling in love.
So for me, more than where he ends up right now, I'm more curious about how stuff pans out with Saidaba. I want to see that conversation or that how that equation ends to whatever conclusion it's taken, whether it translates into something, whether it is like a sad ending, whether it's like a rough ending, whether it's like a good parting between two people. I'm just curious about that because clearly, even throughout this entire thing, when he receives Saidaba's letter, right? And I'm very curious what she's written back, by the way. We didn't get to hear her letter. But he is supremely excited at getting her letter, despite, you know, all this transformational, you know, things that he's going through. Almost a month of no formal communication except a letter between the two of them, which he sent, and now that he's gotten the reply, right? So, I mean, for whatever it is, think about it now, right? Like, now when people do long distance relationships, communication is still difficult. Like, people still struggle with it. Imagine being away from like a person for like who you're in love with. You're not necessarily sure if it's being reciprocated anyway in the first place, or whatever is being reciprocated, it's the same or not. And you're away from that person for a month. You have no communication. You are going through a very transformational experience yourself. So my point being that he clearly has a lot of feelings for her, which like his entire experience has not like kind of blunted that emotion.
Like it's not completely physical. I think we don't give Man enough credit, but he's truly invested in the relationship. Like it's not that he found someone beautiful at one party and like he's with them.
So
sorry, go on.
No, so I mean that's exactly why I'm more focused on, rather than, because that's what Man's character has been for us, right? His pivotal role has been in his as being a paramour of Saidaba. So
I find that so interesting because I don't, like, for me that angle, like I know it's going to end, right? And I'm not invested in how it's going to end. Like I just feel like that's just like, you know, childhood transgression that he's going through, and I feel like now we're gonna get this political leader, the next CM of like their Uttar Pradesh, I think Purva Pradesh, sorry, is like going to emerge, and like that's what Man is about. And I don't know, but for me, like Saidaba is just like not an angle I'm considering anymore at all.
I don't know. I mean, I'm very curious about how it'll end. You were going to say something, sorry, before this.
I was going to say Tasneem seems to be emerging as a new, like, important character. We keep hearing about her in each chapter. Like,
I'm harping back to a theory I'd made earlier about...
Dude, I know what you're going to say.
We've discussed this, like,
about... We discussed this, but I'm on board. I think it's true.
Hai na, mujhe bhi wahi lag raha hai. I mean, that's something I thought right from the start. Like, the Nawab's, there's clearly something fishy happening there. The Nawab's reactions are insane. Particularly when, like, you know, Mahesh Kapoor mentions that Feroz
then he goes
is there and this thing. And that kind of is making me a very, I don't know.
There's
now,
some incest situation, basically.
Yeah, which is going to be terrible for Feroz. Because as far as now, I'm quite, I mean, there's no negative emotions about Feroz for me. I mean, he's a good guy.
I really like Feroz. If I had to crush on any of the characters, it would be Feroz right now, like as things stand.
I would be somewhere short of that just because I don't have enough information about him. Like, he wasn't, obviously, no one went into too much description or detail about him. That's the only thing that's stopping me from actually having a positive opinion of him. As of now, he's just like a good character who exists, like who's doing good things and everything. But
like
I don't
a
know
solid
enough about...
friend, very focused on his family, coming through for his dad, good lawyer.
Exactly.
Like,
he's
like
got
a
every...
solid guy.
Right, exactly.
Good.
Sab chal raha hai, sab changa chal raha
hai. But he might be in love with his sister, basically.
Which is going to be so sad.
What's with Tasneem writing letters to Rashid? Didn't that feel like awkward considering Rashid has a kid and all that? Or did you... I read that as a little more than a student-teacher relationship, but I don't know.
So, I honestly saw it as a cry for help. I think from whatever I've understood about Tasneem in the book is that... So, obviously, her sisters brought her up in a protective zone thinking that, oh, I need to protect her from this big bad world. And I think in Tasneem's eyes, it just, she doesn't see it that way, obviously, that she sees it as I'm being restricted. And clearly we've seen how Saidaba interacts with her. It's a lot of, there's a lot of dismissiveness
order,
there.
Dismissiveness,
and Right. And I think Rashid was a person who treated her with a certain level of respect, because that's something that she mentions also in the letter and also when we were earlier discussing it, that you make me cry for certain purpose. Like, you know, you kind of don't let go. You don't go easy on me. But then that, I know that is self-assuring. Yeah, because you for one are treating me as an adult or as a person on my own, not as like, you know, my sister's sister or something like that. So I think here it's one of those letters which you write to, I don't know, an older friend or like someone you
mentor or something like
that. Yeah, something like that. I didn't particularly pick up a romantic vibe there because, I don't know, I didn't. But maybe there's with this book there could be anything going there.
I don't know. I don't know if it's just like me craving some kind of romance in this like book. It could possibly be that. Yeah. But I also found Rashid's like response not completely teacher like, where he seemed too happy about getting that letter, where I like, to me that was awkwarder than the letter in itself. Like, I really like, I think the letter seemed, and like when you read the letter and you read Rashid's thoughts through it, you can see the difference. It's a child and an adult interacting. Definitely. You can see that clearly the way the letter is written and stuff, which like Vikram says, done that very well. Like, we don't know any of these people's ages, but you have like a sort of idea in terms of how old each one is, and we discussed this earlier also. But yeah, like, I found that interaction a little awkward.
Now, when you mention it, I think there's some subtlety to it, to the extent that Vikram said does talk. Okay, so he brings this up in this perspective where his Rashid's father is talking to Maan about having a like two or three wives, and also in Rashid's thought process about how he thinks about love in itself, and how he's right now just fulfilling his responsibility as a man by like marrying his elder brother's widow and this thing, and maybe that he's not going to find love, that maybe if at all, like if it's heading in that direction, maybe this is just like a base for having Tasneem as a second wife. I don't know, maybe maybe that's what, because he clearly talks about a lot of things about how he's doesn't have company in Brahmapur. He would want to get his family there, but he's also talking about how he's not found love ever. And Maan makes a passing comment on it that, you know, he's discussed this love with Rashid a couple of times, and he's convinced that his knowledge is theoretical. And, right. So
I really like that line, by the way.
What? It's not knowledge is theoretical.
Knowledge of love is theoretical. I also found that interaction really sad, where Rashid goes to his child and the child is like shy of him, and then he calls him Chacha Jaan.
Yeah.
And then later the child is corrected. Like, I my heart really went out for Rashid, like, through that interaction.
It's actually, my heart's gone out for Rashid throughout the book. I don't think there's any point of time where I was just like anti-Rashid at any point of time, because he's clearly like a stellar guy trying to do the right thing, and he's just constantly getting screwed over by everyone. Yeah, and by life. That's the worst part. Like, it's not just like poor guy, he's wanted, like, he's not, I mean, in his personal life he doesn't, he has a decent one but not a great one. He's professionally, and in fact that just brings me back to the baithak that happens, you know, like when they find out, the five of them sit together and they just think it's, I mean, I think that very accurately captures what Rashid's life is, and he tries to do the right thing, and then just everyone gangs up against him and says like, listen, screw you, because right, and I mean that's poor, and he can't do anything about it. He literally, like, even in this scenario, he just walked off. I don't know if he's going to do anything about it, or if at all, how he's going to do anything about this. But I don't know. Heart goes out.
Another two characters were sort of introduced. Not, I don't know if they're complete characters. They're going to be a role, play a role. Is the Munshi and Baris, who work at Behtar House. And I found that exchange really interesting about how the Munshi steals money, and like it really showed you what the, basically Feroz's dad, I forgot his name, but like what he's like. We've been reading that he's slightly aloof, like completely into his library. Right. He's extremely like sweet with his daughter and stuff like that, which is unheard of for like men of that time and stuff like that. So that the fact that he also gets swindled for money and all of that just adds up and like gives another layer to that entire character, right? So I really like that small addition.
For me, I think Baris more than Munshi would have a role to play, I'm assuming. I just love the kind of interaction he had, because that's... I think I've had that interaction with a couple of people back in UP whenever I've traveled. Like, there is someone who... Okay, so ideally, someone who's... say one of your servants or someone who's ideally supposed to, you know, respect you or whatever, or just be formal around you, but isn't, right? And that kind of just develops a better camaraderie between the two of you, that
That's
kind of
true.
happens. But coming back to Nawab Sahib, I think a very, like, even in the part 11, when we hear about how he's been in court only twice, once where he was just bound to make an appearance, he couldn't help it, and one when he'd actually snuck up on Firoz to kind of check, see how his son does. And in both on that occasion, and as well as when he's making his arguments, right? I mean, we clearly see Nawab Sahib, we explicitly see Nawab Sahib being feeling proud of his son and, you know, what he's doing. And that's just, yeah, I know. I mean, that kind, again, just builds into that character we have of him. And
Definitely.
I think that's a very amazing contrast that is put forward, because A, obviously, because of the entire Tasneem thing, that it kind of gives me that the Kite Runner vibe, wherein you have like the stellar character of, you know, with amazing personality and like principles in life, who's generally nice but has committed one big wrong, or maybe. But the other part being that the contrast with the Raja of Mard, right? Like, because, okay, so we're seeing the Zamindari win, and the idea is that you see it from the perspective that Zamindars are evil to this thing. And for once, we're seeing, like, okay, a person who owns a lot of property is actually not that bad a person. Like, he's at, right? And we've obviously not seen his direct comments about his people who work on his land or anything. But we've seen enough to know that a lot of the times, some of the exploitation that happens on his land is done by his Munshi. He's very considerate about how things are going. Like, something after the stampede in at Kulmela, he stops the Eid celebration at his house simply because, you know, there's something bad that happened in the
Not
city,
yet,
right? How he reaches out to Mahesh Kapoor and like everything. So, I mean, that kind of just, I think that's a brilliant contrast to study, because the Raja of Mard is shown to be like a typical zamindar who, like, you know, is exploitative, is rude, brash, arrogant, everything. And on the other hand, you have the Nawab's family, very well respected, soft spoken, nice people who actually aren't exploitative, just like just own land. They're still fighting against the zamindar, though. So obviously they're not going to let go of land. That, like,
But
that's not,
there's a different way of doing it, right? They're on the same sides, but completely opposite to each other.
Right. And that just, like, is something very interesting. Like, it's because, like, I mean, I want to see the reaction of how this entire thing goes through, right? Once they're deprived of their property, what both these characters have as a reaction. I think that'll be a very
That's true.
interesting thing to watch out for.
True. And for me, another like sort of comparison, like I really like, I've said this before, for me the true ship is Nawab and Mahesh Kapoor's friendship. And there was a small exchange over there also about like the Nawab telling Mahesh Kapoor, saying that he's gonna come and see Firoz in court, which shows that he thinks of that person as a child, right? Like, and that
Clearly.
was very endearing. But you can see the difference in these two equations of the fathers and the sons, Mahesh Kapoor and Maan, and the Nawab and Firoz, right? Like how proud one father is of the child and how loyal the child is to the father and obedient he is versus this. And the true conflict is actually going to come because the child is not going to, if our theory is right, is not going to be able to like get his love because of his father's like one mistake or whatever, right? So I'm really looking forward to that entire interaction, and I hope there's this scene of Mahesh Kapoor talking Firoz's dad down and like basically talking about how fatherhood is and stuff. I don't know if that'll happen, but like
I know,
for
I mean,
me, these are the two characters like I think will I which are the most like interesting comparison, right? You would think that Maan and Pran is what you would compare, but I constantly compare Firoz and Maan as a reader.
I don't know if you've seen this show called Boston Legal. Okay, so there's
Of
this,
course.
you have, right? So at the end of every episode, Danny Crane and Alan Shore do this thing where
Sit
they
and
have
have a drink.
drink and like smoke a cigar on the cigarette terrace. I think I want to see that scene with like the Nawab and Mahesh Kapoor, like
Exactly,
eventually,
right?
like after the judgments come out and shit, and they just go and sit and like listen.
We're
I just
on
want to
the
see that.
opposite sides.
Yeah, I mean,
Yeah.
clearly, like, even during the case, they're chilling, having lunch together and whatnot. So obviously, like, that is just a bygone conclusion, right? Like, listen, we're friends regardless. I am
Yeah.
literally depriving you of money and your wealth. I am solely responsible for it, but still we're good friends, right? So
Yeah.
that's a very, just a interesting bit
Yeah,
to.
and that small like interaction in court was again like something that was really endearing for me when he came to see Feroz like be a
Yeah, like,
lawyer
it's
and
just,
stuff.
yeah,
Yeah.
kind of really built up there. I think that's about it. I don't think I have anything more to add. So
Yeah.
So yeah, thank you everyone for tuning in. Do let drop us your DMs or about any feedback about this or the show or the book. We'll be back on Sunday. We'll be doing the next two parts now. We'll be doing 12 and 13. So yeah.
Let's hope strategies are in it.
Yes, he was hoping. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.